Kjære alle sammen, hjertelig velkommen til Krimfestivalen 2021. Jeg heter Kari Wikland, og jeg gleder meg veldig til å møte den britiske bestsellerforfatteren Claire McIntosh, som har toppet alle bestsellerlister og solgt over 2 millioner bøker verden rundt, etter at hun debuterte med «Jeg lar deg gå» i 2015. Og siden har det blitt 4 bøker, og den siste, Gissel på norsk, Hostage på engelsk, den kommer i mai. Og dere kan glede dere, for jeg har lest den, en fantastisk spennende bok. So, hello Claire. Thank you for your last book, which was amazing. Kept me up at night like a good book, good crime should. And this will be published all over in May, June. So how's life at the moment, Claire?
Well, you know, like it is for everyone, it's very strange, and I'm still not really used to it. I'm finding it very difficult to write and to find a creative space in a house full of children who still aren't in school. But I'm healthy, and I'm very, very fortunate to be doing a job that I love and that I can do from home, and I can still connect with readers around the world. So I feel very lucky.
We should have really liked to have you here, like you have been here before. We love that. But okay, this is the way it's going to be this year, and we're so happy you could be with us. So just start with the book, which I feel has so many layers, I think, family and secrets and this plane, which is hijacked. But in the center of it all, it's Mina. Do you say Mina or Mina?
Mina.
Mina. Mina and her husband, Adam, and their daughter, Sophia. And how would you describe this family?
Well, they are actually a very average family. Family. And this is something that I love to do, which is to write about ordinary people who find themselves in extraordinary situations. And so Mina and Adam have been married for a number of years. They've previously had a very good, very strong relationship. They're going through a bit of a rocky patch at the moment. Adam's keeping some secrets. Actually, Mina's got some secrets of her own. And they have a very lovely, very, very clever, bright, but very challenging daughter, Sophia, who's 5 years old. She has additional needs, some attachment issues, maybe some autism. It's not clear in the book, but nevertheless, she has these challenges. And that puts a huge amount of pressure on both parents and on their relationship. And so that's the point at which we join them when Mina goes off on this very special flight.
Yeah, because it's Christmas time, and she normally likes to be with her family before Christmas. But as you say, they have difficulties in their relationship without telling too much, and they also need the money. So she signs up for this special flight. And what can you tell about this flight?
Well, so the reason it's special is because it is the first ever direct flight from London to Sydney. Now, this is actually a route that will happen. I think it was supposed to start running this year, in fact. It might have been pushed back a bit. But it's been there have been preparations, both in real life and in my novel, for a number of years to have this direct flight. It's 20 hours long. And she is part of this team of cabin crew that will take this flight. The plane is packed with celebrities, journalists. The world's media is looking at this plane. And there's very much a sort of a Titanic feel about it, that here is a route that will make headlines. But of course, it's going to make headlines for all the wrong reasons.
And then everything seems very nice in the beginning. Like you say, there's influencers, there's journalists, everybody who matters are on this flight, it seems like. And then everything goes completely wrong, and Mina has to make a terrible choice. I don't know how much you want to reveal to, well, or how much you want to spoil.
That's always so difficult. It's such a challenge, isn't it, for you as
always,
interviewers?
Yeah.
You know, how much do we give away? I think it's okay to say that near the beginning of this flight, Mina receives an anonymous contact from one of the passengers on this plane. So it becomes very, very clear that someone on the plane has plans and wants to involve Mina in them. And she has to make a decision. Does she save the lives of everyone on that plane? Or does she focus on the most important people in her life, her husband and her daughter?
And I think this feeling of being inside a plane, you can't get out. You're going to be inside there for 20 hours and there's people inside who do horrible things. And it reminded me in a way about, you know, the Agatha Christie murder on the Orient Express. You are locked inside. Did this inspire you?
Yes, absolutely. So I love locked room mysteries. And when I was writing Hostage, I had a note on my computer which said Murder on the Orient Express meets Con Air. So that's my that's where the book sits. So it's a contemporary version of that classic locked room mystery where you can't go anywhere. The suspects are right there, but you don't know who to trust. And you can't run.
It's claustrophobic. And you tell the story from two perspectives because back in England, Adam and Sophia are also struggling for their lives, or there is no peace and quiet Christmas, pre-Christmas time there either. And I feel kind of very sorry for him because he just has this feeling that he's not important enough in his daughter's life, that he does everything wrong, and he's lying to his wife, and he's a police officer, and he's lying to his colleagues, and he's on a love level in his life. And I don't know how much you can say about that. Why is everything so difficult?
I think that life for dads is quite a hard one. I think that there's an awful lot of support given to mothers. And although there are expectations that mothers can do certain things, actually there are even greater expectations sometimes placed on dads who aren't allowed to be emotional or broken or struggle. You know, they're supposed to just keep doing what they're doing, bringing in the money and being strong. And Adam isn't coping very well, but is unable to tell people that his world is crumbling. And he struggles a lot with jealousy, which is something that I think happens a lot in families between mums and dads, you know, because children do play one off against the other sometimes. I know mine do. And sometimes they want to be with mum and sometimes they want to be with dad. And from Adam's perspective, Sophia just wants to be with Mina all the time. You know, she is really quite controlling as a child. Mm. And so Adam's very much left on the outside. And that has gradually affected his relationship both with his daughter and his wife. So he's really feeling quite isolated.
Mm. Yeah. And I think also for Mina, it's sometimes too much. She has to lock herself into the toilet just to, you know, have some... One very interesting thing about Sophia is the way you describe her, like she can narrate, how do you say it in English, narrates her way to school. She tells this story 1,000 times. You pass the grocery, you pass the bookshop, you pass the... And, I mean, yeah, you maybe have to have some level of calm inside you to follow her all the time.
She likes routine. She likes things to be exactly the same all the time. And she has these patterns and these behaviours that are very soothing for her and very reassuring. But, they are quite irritating, I guess, for her parents. And then we uncover during the course of the book why this is actually a really important thing for Sophia and for the whole family.
We will go back to the horrible choice Mina has to take. But one thing which really fascinated me was the way you tell small short stories about the passengers in the plane. And it just occurred to me, I mean, you can be in a plane, you can be in a train, and there's so many lives around you with their dreams, with their backgrounds, with their hopes for the future. So that's a fascinating thing you do in the book, I think.
I am obsessed with the stories of people traveling. And, you know, I started writing this book when I traveled a lot for work. I was always going to different countries to talk about my books. And so I spent a lot of time at airports and on aeroplanes. And I used to love looking at everyone and thinking, you know, what's your story? What's your journey? What brought you? Why this plane? Why this day? Why this airport? Why this trip? Where are you going? Who are you going to see? And every single one of those passengers has got a story to tell. And I really wanted to tell some of those stories and to sort of humanize, I suppose, this hostage situation.
Yeah, I don't know how much we shall say about the hijackers. We can maybe leave that to the readers, don't you think? But we can. But like you said before, this I feel this is also very much a book about a mother's choice and how what you willing to do to protect your child or the people who are closest to you. And this is a theme which interests you, I know, from earlier books as well.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I seem to return, don't I, to mothers and children in pretty much every book, even when I don't set out to do that. But, you know, we all have something in our life, don't we, that we would protect beyond anything else. And that might be a child, it might be a relative, a best friend. So I was a police officer, as you know, for a long time. And what that taught me above everything else was that we are all capable of doing terrible things if the right buttons are pressed. And you know, there'll be a lot of people watching this who will think, well, I would never commit murder. And I would challenge that because I am a moral, upstanding person who would never want to hurt anyone. But there are situations in which I can absolutely imagine myself being pushed to commit terrible crimes to protect someone else. So I think that's the area that I like to explore. And the flip side of that, just to sort of go back, you mentioned how we can't say too much about the baddies in this book. But I think what we can say is that just as I think every good person is capable of bad things, I think that bad people are capable of loving and of good, warm, positive things. And again, as a police officer, I dealt with, I worked quite a lot with protesters, demonstrators, as a negotiator between two different sides to try and find a compromise. And I found it really interesting to see these people as people. And so when we see them on the news and perhaps, you know, we see them storming the Capitol or whatever they're doing, and as a group, they're terrorists, they're aggressors, but individually each of those people has a family, has a backstory, has a reason why they feel the way they do and why their values have been molded to such a point that they are now in this situation. And so that's a lot of what I was doing in Hostage.
Yeah. And you said it yourself, you worked as a police officer for 12 years and you used some of your own experiences in your first book, I'll Let You Go. Isn't that right? So, and the book you wrote before this one, Hostage, it's not a crime novel. It's called After the End. It's a heartbreaking novel about a young couple and their fatally ill, the child who is fatally ill. And also choices, extremely difficult choices. And it struck me that even these books are so different. It's kind of the same theme, as you said yourself, the love for your child and how it affects you and and difficult choices. Do you agree? It's the same kind absolutely. Of theme, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting when people say, you know, After the End is completely different from your crime novels. And actually, you're completely right in what you say, that you can look at my books and you can find these common threads. And yeah, After the End and Hostage are both about very, you know, very difficult choices that are motivated by the love of a child. And so they may well sit in different parts of the bookshop, but actually they're really quite similar.
And this book also was in one way based on something you have also experienced in your family.
Yeah, After the End is a book that I'd wanted to write for a really, really long time. So in 2008, my son was very, very ill, and we had to make a decision about whether we kept fighting, kept trying different treatments, and tried to buy some time, knowing that he would live with very, very severe disabilities to the point where he would be unable to walk or talk or see or hear, or whether we removed him from intensive care and let him die. And when I asked the consultant, what happens if we don't agree? So if my husband and I don't agree, because, you know, like most couples, we disagreed on all sorts of things and they'd never mattered until this moment. And the consultant said, you have to agree because the alternative is unthinkable. And we did agree, but I wanted to write about a couple who disagreed, because something very interesting happens when you have children, which is that you don't love your partner any less, but suddenly you love your child more. And actually, if in some circumstances you find yourself having to choose between the two, and that's what happens in After the End. Mm.
It's a very strong and very beautiful, heartbreaking novel, I think. But was it for you very different to write a crime book and this novel? Or do you just feel it's the same way of thinking and the same way of writing?
Well, there was a big difference after. So I wrote three crime novels, I Let You Go, I See You, Let Me Lie. And then it did feel very different writing After the End. And some of that was because there was some personal attachment to it. But actually, mostly it was because my first crime novels were very plot driven. And so the focus when I was writing was the action, what happens next, you know, where are the twists and the turns? And After the End was more character led. So I had to really know who Pip and Max were and what motivated them. And then the story evolved out of their choices. So it was very different. But then what I found when I came to write Hostage, which is technically, I would have assumed to be another plot-led book, actually, I had learned so much from writing After the End that it became a sort of hybrid of the two. And so I worked just as much on the character of Pip and Mina and, you know, who of Mina and Adam and who they were and, you know, what motivated them, as on the twists and turns of the plot.
Yeah, I felt that this book was a little bit more like the last one, yeah. But it's even though it's extremely, extremely, you sit up at night and read this last book because you have to know what's happening. So you've been very successful with the crime plot in this book. But this, as you explained to us now, like using your own experience from your own life, do you do that all the time when you write, or...?
I guess I do. I don't set out to do it. So you know, after the end is an exception. I can't imagine I'll write another book like that. But generally, I don't think, right, which incident in my life am I going to write about? But, you know, Hostage, for example, came about when I was on a plane. So not a 20-hour flight, but a 14, 15-hour flight to San Francisco, to Seattle. And it was such a long time to be in the air. And we're so used to being connected all the time, you know, to knowing exactly where everyone is and what they're doing. And so it felt really odd and sort of otherworldly to be in this place, you know, and not have contact. And a friend of mine who is a pilot said that aeroplanes are like cities suspended in the air. And just like in cities, people fall ill and they're born and they die. And this sort of this feeling of a completely closed society in an aeroplane was really appealing. So that was the start of the novel. And then as I started writing it and the characters of the parents evolved and their child evolved, I realized that actually that relationship was really key. And I have a daughter with additional needs and some attachment issues. And so I know firsthand how challenging that can be and how exhausting it can be, however much you love someone, to be looking after them 24/7. So I guess I ended up putting quite a bit of that into the novel.
Yeah, and there is a little bit of me too in the novel as well, because Mina has
passed
as well, because she really was training to be a pilot. And then that's also a very strong side story, I think.
Yeah.
Why she ended up quitting her education to be a pilot, and her parents had paid all the schools and everything, sold her house in France to pay for her education, then suddenly from one day to another, she just quits. But when we read the book, we understand why. Also,
yes, we won't talk too much about that, but yes, absolutely.
No,
it's quite topical, I suppose, in that sense.
Yeah, it's, like you said, you used to travel a lot. Do you miss it now, or do you feel just a little bit happy to don't be in an airplane all the time? You miss
it? I miss it so much. To be in a hotel room or, you know, at an airport. It's interesting because for much of the last year before the pandemic, I was starting to think, I'm traveling too much. I need to be at home. My kids are getting older and they're out all the time and I don't see them. And I was feeling a bit sort of empty nest. And then the pandemic hit and we were all forced to stay at home. And there's been a lot about the last 12 months that I have really loved, because it's given me a second chance to have all my children at home. But now I have had enough of that.
you have three lockdowns, isn't that right? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
In
the
UK, yeah.
Three lockdowns.
But yes, because that's hard. Yeah, yeah, he really had it in the UK. But now maybe I saw on television that maybe things are going to loosen up a little bit, isn't it?
It's definitely getting better, and I'm, you know, very hopeful that we'll be traveling again, because what I miss is from a work perspective, I miss the creative stimulus that travel gives me.
Yeah.
So, you know, meeting different people from different backgrounds, sitting in cafes and listening to different accents, different voices. That is all, you know, that they all find their way into novels somehow, and meeting readers. And that is, you know, it's genuinely inspiring to go and speak to readers and hear what they loved about my books and to hear them looking forward to a new book. That's what keeps me going all year round, you know, those small bits of people saying, I can't wait for your next book, is what buoys me up when I'm having a tricky writing day. And so not having that, because it's not the same online, you know, this is great. We can have our conversation and that sense is pretty much the same. But I want to see all these people, you know, I want to see everyone out there and I want to see what else they're reading and hear their questions. And I'm finding that really hard. I miss that.
We'll hope we see you in the Crime Festival next year, Claire, that everybody, you can live in a hotel and you can go on the plane and you can watch people and you can hear their stories and maybe write it in another book. So thank you for being with us today, and good luck with the publishing of the of your book, which it falls out all the time, I'm sorry, which I really loved. And thank you. Og så husk at det jo 50 forfattere dere kan møte her på Krimfestivalen. Det bare å logge seg på krimfestivalen.no. Så ses vi. Takk for meg.